Hey, this is Pastor Efrem Smith from Bayside Midtown Campus. But right now, I'm just the little Rev from the living room, and I'm so glad to be with you. And I want to read to you from the book of Genesis, the first book of the Bible, chapter 1. And I'm going to start with verse 24. And God said, "Let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds, the livestock, the creatures that move along the ground, and the wild animals, each according to its kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds, and God said it was good. Then God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground." Sisters and brothers, here at the beginning, we see that God makes human beings different than he makes the animals. God made the birds in the sky after their kind. God made the fish in the sea after their kind. God made the animals on the ground after their kind. So animals were created to live amongst each other, but to live in their kind. Human beings, though, we were made different. We weren't made after brown kinds and black kinds and white kinds and red kinds and yellow kinds. God made one humanity. Male and female, we were made in God's image. But God desired that we would go across the entire planet that God created, and we would be fruitful, and we would multiply, which means that eventually humanity would have become diverse, but we were meant to live together as one human family made in the image of God. What changed that? Sin. I mean, as you move on in the book of Genesis, you read about in chapters 2 and 3, sin coming into the world, and that brings division. In the first family, a brother, Cain, would kill his brother, Abel. By chapter 11, humanity is building a tower unto itself to worship itself, not to worship God in whose image we were made, but to worship ourselves. That's the dilemma we find ourselves in. I'm going to do something in this devotion that I don't normally do. I'm going to talk about race, and I'm going to talk about it in a way that may cause discomfort for you. But I have to keep it real for you so that we can strive to be the people that God created us to be. Last week, a video went viral. It broke my heart. A young African-American man named Ahmad in the state of Georgia was going out for a jog. But because of the color of his skin, he was suspected to be someone who was bringing crime to his community. And two men who happened to be white, a father and son, got into a pickup truck. They had guns with them. They tracked him down, Ahmad. They tracked Ahmad down. They cut him off, and he was murdered. Now, you may say, "Hey, you're going too far, Pastor Efrem. The investigation is not done yet." I mean, yes, they arrested the father and the son, but there's much more to do. Yeah, but if you watch the video, it's pretty tough. I mean, if you watch that video, it ought to cause you to grieve, lament right now. And I'm not just talking about a video. I could share with you from my own life. I've been pulled over by the police just because of the color of my skin. I've been in my own driveway and had a police officer pull up to my driveway, roll down the window and say, "What are you doing in this neighborhood? What are you doing standing in this driveway?" And my response was, "Sir, I live here." I've been called the N-word multiple times. I've had to watch people in my own community drive around flying the Confederate flag, even though I thought where I live is above the Mason-Dixon line, and it's been years and years since the Civil War. I have to wonder, when I leave my own house now, is it safe for me because of the color of my skin? This is the world in which we live, a world of sin, a world of racialized division, a world of oppression, a world of supremacy, a world that still lives in a racialized matrix, where based on the color of your skin, your physical features, we decide who's fast, who's slow, who's dumb, who's smart, who should be feared, who should be revered. This is the world in which we live in, and my particular skin color in that race matrix, in that framework, has been deemed on the bottom. This is the world in which we live. I'm a descendant of slaves. My parents know what it's like to live through Jim Crow segregation. My parents know what it's like to look at white-only signs. I was the first in my family to take advantage of the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act, to live in an integrated world across the nation, but yet the issue of race is still real. Some of you may not agree with the narrative I'm painting, or at least the entirety of it, but I would hope that you would receive me even more deeply now in this Devo as your brother, as a pastor, than you did in the Devos where I didn't talk about race and you loved them. I pray that as my heart grieves, as my family stayed up to midnight last night talking about, is it safe for us to leave our house in the world in which we live because the color of our skin, we might be profiled, suspected of being a thief, a murderer, a gang member, someone that would do harm, that would cause white folks to fear us. I hope that you would grieve with me. I hope you would understand why I took this Devo to talk to you like this, why my heart is broken, why I'm nervous, why my daughters are scared, why my wife is nervous for me to leave the house. We can fix this, though. We can do something about this if we would rise as reconcilers. I'm not painting a negative picture of all police officers. I'm not painting a negative picture of all white people, but I'm painting a real picture. And it's a picture that the whole entire Christian church in America should rise to the occasion around. We should be able to talk about racism, white supremacy, white privilege, and that not cause offense, defensiveness with my white brothers and sisters. I need you not to be offended by me, but to live in this with me, that we might know that compassion and justice and love and peace and reconciliation are essential components of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's not enough just to preach and teach on relationships and finances and family and happiness and principles for understanding discipleship. Those are critical and important. But I hope that you would hear my heart today, and you would grieve with me, and we would do something about racism and prejudice and hatred and oppression. We would be voices. We would have lives of love and unity and peace. We're not supposed to live like animals, and we're not supposed to look at other people as if they're animals. We're supposed to live together as those made in the image of God. I hope you'll join me. God bless you.